My earliest memory is falling on my head off a swing onto the hard playground of the Chelsea Babies Club sometime in 1932. I don't remember whether it hurt or not, but I do remember the hours my mother spent trying to get the blood clots out of my hair. The Chelsea Babies Club was a determinedly progressive nursery, which believed in healthy exercise year-round in the open air. Winter long, we skipped and frolicked in sturdy knickers and liberty bodices, reddened and blued by the cold. The presiding enthusiast for this Spartan regime was a Miss Bunn, around whom glowing infants flourished like weeds. The Babies Club was at the end of our road. My parents, my older brother and I, lived in a long, thin house with a long, thin garden in Glebe Place, a street much favoured by actors, artists and other Chelsea characters. It was a house full of challenges. My own favourite as a toddler was to climb my father's bookshelves right to the very top, where the forbidden books were kept. One floor of the house was the domain of my mother's beloved friend, Winifred Holtby. Winifred, who had met my mother as a student at Somerville College, Oxford, was, like her, a writer. After university, the two young women had rented a flat in Doughty Street and together tried to break into the world of journalism. When my mother married, she and my father shared their home with Winifred. With eyes the colour of cornflowers and hair the white gold of summer wheat in her native Yorkshire wolds, Winifred was unforgettable. Tall, nearly 6 feet and slim, she was incandescent with the radiance of her short and concentrated life, for she died aged 37, when I was only 5. For us children, my older brother John and me, she was the source of unending pleasure. Stories, games, exotic visitors, and carved wooden crocodiles from Africa. I even forgave her when, in an absent-minded moment, she handed me undiluted antiseptic to gargle away a sore throat. My mother before the war was a conscientious but rather remote parent. My brother and I were brought up to respect her work. She was the family's main breadwinner. My passionate and protective love for her, for she was painfully vulnerable like many shy people, developed much later, when I was mature enough to understand how rare were her qualities of courage and of uncomfortable, uncompromising integrity. My mother did, however, allow herself some moments of frivolity. She loved clothes and used to take me with her while she tried on the elegant polka-dotted dresses and emphatic hats of the 30s. A new hat or pair of gloves could lift her spirits for days. It was a pleasure I did not share. After the first 10 minutes of each encounter with a supercilious sales lady, I began to think about horses and bicycles and to resent the waste of my time. Through the banisters overlooking the entrance hall, we children used to watch the visitors come and go. These were the years when my mother, Vera Brittain, enjoyed a brief period of fame as a best-selling writer. Her most renowned book, Testament of Youth, an autobiography of her experience as a nurse in the First World War, had attracted enthusiastic reviews on both sides of the Atlantic. She was invited to carry out exhausting lecture tours in North America, reached by haughty white liners with 3 or 4 funnels. Her stateroom in those liners was always full of flowers and showers of yellow telegrams. With the fame, too, came access to all sorts of renowned and notorious people. My mother was initially thrilled, and then learned that such friends rarely last. The first breeze of controversy over my mother's pacifist views, once pacifism ceased to be popular, blew many of them away. My father, who was both kindly and brave, had an absurdly exaggerated respect for worldly fame. All the odder, given that he was a scholar of Catholic theology. He adored meeting the great, and the great poseurs of the political world. He was the reason for the cocktail parties that brought all kinds of visitors to our house. Most thrilling of all to us children were the African visitors, for we had never before encountered anyone with a black skin. Among them were Clements Kadalie, the leader of the first South African trade union, and a deep-voiced, quiet man called Chief Lutuli, who later led the African National Congress, both of whom Winifred had met on a visit in 1926 to South Africa. Just as she was committed to righting the injustices suffered by black South Africans, so my father threw himself into the cause of the independence of India. One day, a slim young visitor, with dark rings under haunted brown eyes, came to tea to meet fellow socialists in Britain. Jawaharlal Nehru was already leading the fight for the independence of India. Despite the visitors and the occasional parties, ours was a highly disciplined household. Determinedly professional, my parents and Winifred were at work in their studies by 10 a.m, after reading the papers and sorting out the shopping lists and the bills. Every member of the household well understood that only death, war, or a serious accident would justify an interruption. Politics pulsed through our meals and our family conversations. Mussolini stalked through our soup, and Franco smirked in our puddings. Hitler's relentless ascent to power was an ever-darkening shadow over our ordered lives. My parents had heard him speak in Cologne in March 1936, the day before the election in the Rhineland, and had shuddered at his extraordinary capacity to shape men and women to his will. I, of course, understood little of all this, though I was addicted to the cartoons of David Lowe, a great friend of my parents. But I did understand that no one would pay me much attention unless I engaged in political conversation too. "You're only interested in Hitler, not in me," I informed them at the age of 5. I confused the Reichstag fire with the Crystal Palace fire. They became one single awful conflagration in my mind. That politics were the most exciting of all the exciting things in the world, I did not doubt. At age 1, I had been pushed in a pram round Brentford and Chiswick, the first of my father's unsuccessful forays as a Labour candidate in a general election. At 5, I was told all about his campaign in Sunderland. A stranger to luck, the first election in which he failed to campaign in the Labour interest was that of 1945. The politics of the dictatorship were the politics of hatred and revenge. The politics of Britain were the politics of misery. Shabby men, wearing the tarnished medals of the Great War for Civilization, stood in the gutters, selling matches and shoelaces. Unable to pass the stooped seller of violets, my mother found a shilling for him. But we knew he wanted not a shilling, but a job. The violets, hanging their small heads over the glass we put them in, seemed to sense our shame. I had left the babies' club when I was 4 years old for the more demanding atmosphere of Mrs. Spencer's academy at Brecon Place, South Kensington, a small school of scrubbed, rosy, neatly uniformed boys and girls, emulating their parents' image of the well-disciplined middle-class child. 2 years after Winifred Holtby's early death from Bright's disease, when our family moved from Glebe Place in 1937 to the grander surroundings of Cheyne Walk, I pleaded with my parents to let me attend the local school, Christchurch Elementary. Christchurch Elementary School was a mid-Victorian building with classrooms of high brown wooden walls topped by yellowing glass. Some of the classrooms had folding doors between them. When a teacher was ill or absent, the folding doors between classes were pushed back. In between the two classrooms, each of perhaps 40 children, sat the teacher on a high wooden stool with a long cane across her lap. Chatting among the children, let alone the throwing of poker darts, led to immediate and painful punishment. Many of my fellow pupils were pasty and skinny. Some had the bowed legs of rickets. Their lifeless woollen jerseys had holes in the elbows, and they wore shorts and skirts cut down after long use by older brothers and sisters. From time to time, all of us went through the indignity of having our heads searched for lice. One family in my class took turns to come to school. I asked one of them why. Between them, they had only 2 pairs of boots, and the children had to share them. I asked my mother why I had 4 pairs of shoes and 2 pairs of sandals, while they had half of one. At Christmas, the thoughtful London County Council gave every child a bag of sweets and either a paper doll or a set of crayons. For many, it was all the Christmas presents they ever received. I had a farm set of animals and barns and a tricycle as well. I didn't understand why there was such a difference.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.